Last but certainly not least, we have the TurboVote folks. Come up.
I'm Paul from TurboVote. I'm the research director there. What we do is we make it as easy as possible to get registered to vote, stay registered to vote, and vote by mail no matter where you move for the rest of your life. So without further ado, let's do a test registration just so you can see what it looks like as you're going through. So, start out with basics. You guys are going to learn more about me tonight than I usually tell a room full of strangers. You do need to be a U.S. citizen to vote. Confirm our address. Now, we can offer you the option to register to vote by absentee or mail ballot, or if you just really, really like your polling place, we can make sure that you always remember to go there. I am a 90s baby. Try not to hold it against me. Not going to give you my phone number. You have to ask for that. We will see how that goes over in the Brooklyn Board of Elections. New York is one of many states that does require you to have an excuse to vote by mail. I'm going to be absent from New York City on Election Day. New York is also one of many states that gives you the option to register online. We're integrated with many of those. For now, I'm going to skip over that option and just say I want to register by mail. TurboVote is free. I'm going to say that again for emphasis. We are a free service. We will send you all of the forms you need, email and text message reminders at absolutely no cost. But if it turns out that you're really allergic to stamp glue or just incredibly lazy, we are happy to provide you the forms for the $1.60 it costs us to send them to you. So give your information one more look over, hit continue. And you're done. And in about 5 seconds, we should have PDF forms here. I'm now going to jump over to, with some assistance, I'm going to jump over to a set of slides with some of the legal issues we face. So this is what an email from TurboVote to me after I'd finished the process would look like. Complete with another copy of the forms in case I failed to grab them at the web page. Now, there are three big areas of policy issues that we face. The first is elections. Let's say it's a beautiful December afternoon in Milwaukee. And I'm wondering whether there's a school board election coming up, which I found out yesterday that there actually is. So how would I find that out? Given that the state of Wisconsin doesn't have any sort of central repository where they actually list when elections are taking place. Now that's pretty straightforward. You give the Board of Elections a call. This only gets a little more complicated if you want to keep track of elections other places. And you remember that actually Wisconsin's a pretty big place. And there are about 1,910 different offices you would have to deal with in the state of Wisconsin alone to keep track of every election. And remember also that you would have to call all of them more than once, because, you know, there could be a recall election with only 6 weeks warning. Wisconsin's a little worse than most. Across the United States, you would need to deal with about 7,500 offices. But that still means that if I'm making all of these phone calls, there will need to be about 10 of me in order to get it done. Our next main category of problems is voter ID. You may have heard a few words about that in the lead up to the 2012 elections. We want to make sure that people have everything they need to vote, and that includes information about what kinds of IDs they need to provide when they register and go to vote. Now, in most states, it's pretty straightforward. You need to provide ID, which can be photo ID, non-photo ID, or a bill or piece of government correspondence. If you didn't provide it when you registered, bad on you, and you're a first-time voter in that state. Some places like Alaska make it a little more complicated. In Alaska, there are actually different rules depending on whether you're registering from inside the state or from somewhere else entirely. The third big category of problems has to do with excuses. You need an excuse to vote by mail in many states, 18 to be precise. 32 in DC are much friendlier and don't require you to give an excuse. Now, in most states, these are pretty straightforward. For example, if you're a college student, you can vote by mail. Or if your work requires a lot of travel, again, you can vote by mail. But some places make it a little more complicated. For example, in Louisiana, you can be confined to a mental institution. And as long as it is inside the parish in which you're registered, you are still not eligible to vote by mail. In fairness to Louisiana, though, they did have the foresight to make it a legal excuse to vote by mail if you're on a boat for work. Sadly, though, they did not. It is not acceptable to vote by mail in Louisiana if you're on a boat only for fun. These are the three big categories of problems that we have to contend with in order to make sure that that users' voting experience is as seamless as possible when they come to us. Thank you.
How much of the country do you guys cover right now?
So we serve the entire United States. We can cover any of the 50 states and DC. We have 58 colleges and universities, which are not in every state, but are spread out across many states, and we have about 200,000 users total.
Okay. Sorry if I missed this at the beginning, but are you guys interested in just sticking with the keyword voting registration sort of aspect, or do you like expand into information about candidates and that sort of stuff as well?
So leading up to the 2012 elections, we partnered with an organization that was simplifying people's access to their ballot previews. So we sent every user an email with information about, or with a link to a page that would give them access to all of the state-provided data about what was on their ballot. And in the future, we would like to branch out and do more voter information, consistently give people access to polling place information and so forth. We are a nonpartisan organization, so when we say informing voters, we are very careful that we are informing voters only in strictly nonpartisan fashion.
I'll do one.
If someone would attempt to commit voter fraud using your system, would you be liable?
I am not a lawyer, and so I'm not going to answer that question on the spot.
If you were, you wouldn't either, so.
What have you contemplated in the way of liability for people using your service for like some sort of fraud?
Everything we do is held to the same standards that registration normally is. We provide you with the forms that you need to turn in, at which point you turn them in to your local Board of Elections, county clerk, whatever the official happens to be called, and they're responsible for processing them. Everything we do is held to the same standards that all of the United States is.
I was not a 90s baby. I've been voting for a little bit longer. Traditionally, I always voted with the same type of machine. And this year in New York, they changed the machines that we used. It caused a lot of backlog, caused people to spend a lot more time trying to figure it out, had a lot of confusion around it. Is there a way to determine, based on somebody's polling place, what type of machines they would be using? You talked about a ballot preview, which is what made me think of it. is there a way that you could provide people with access and maybe access to videos or something about what they're going to experience, what they're going to do when they actually get to that polling place?
So you asked two. You actually asked two questions, which I'm going to split up. The first is, is there a way to provide people information about what kinds of voting machines they're going to encounter? As far as I know, there is no data source specifically for that. Although if there is, I would personally love to provide it to people. That's the sort of thing that one state probably has buried somewhere on a website, and in 10 years, five states will. The second question is just generally, is there a way we can provide information to people about what they're going to encounter at the polling place? If somebody has a good resource on that, I would personally be really excited about providing something like that.
Catherine, do you have a planted question, maybe?
No, I'm specific.
Or a comment. All right, thank you to TurboVote.